Would you join me in prayer, please? Father God, we thank you so much for this power that comes directly from you. And Lord, it doesn't help us to be people after our own hearts. Lord, it helps us to be people after your heart. So Lord, as we come before your word today, I just pray that you would use it with power, not only to tenderize our hearts, Lord, but to renew our minds and to help us to be the people that you've always meant for and called us to be. We pray this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. We're continuing, well, ending, bringing to a close this series on Philippians. It's been our summer series. And at this point, if you've been here throughout the whole series, you've heard every word of the book of Philippians. It's been powerful. I've heard lots of feedback about how this book of the Bible has really been touching people. And so what I want to do, again, I kind of told you before we began, this is that moment where I want to give people an opportunity, just, you know, a few people, if you're brave enough. We're going to talk out loud in church. It's okay. We're going to talk to each other. You're not just going to sit there and just stare at me. We're going to talk. So what I want to do is I want to ask, if we have some brave souls here that would love to say in throughout this series, what thought, maybe it's a personal thought for them, or maybe it's a general thought that's kind of lifted through this series. Does anybody want to give it a try? Who wants to start? Anybody? Very good. Thank you. I'll just sit down now. That was great. Thank you. Anybody else? Well said. Yes, Jeff. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Jeff said that he's got a lot of transition right now. He's transitioning jobs, kind of some new things, and it's just been this affirmation that he can do all things through Christ who strengthens him. Thank you. Anybody else? Yeah, whoever. First one to stand, yes. Yeah. That's awesome. Steve said that just the timelessness of Scripture and how everything that was relevant then is still relevant today. Thank you. Very good. Yes, Carol. Yeah. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. See, just because you're going through a hard time doesn't mean you have nowhere to go. Very good. Thank you. One more. Got one more brave person want to say something? Yes, Casey. Excellent. And just so you know, a little bit in this message, you were not a plant. Okay, because people are going to look at you and say, oh, you guys worked that out somehow. The power in the promise is what she said. Remember that, the power in the promise. Casey, I love you, girl. You set me up so well. Praise the Holy Spirit for that one. The power in the promise. So you see, this is how things work collectively, and it's just this really powerful picture. Now, what I want to do, I'm going to summarize. Again, because we've been through the entire book of Philippians, I'm now going to read you every word again. No, I'm not. I'm just kidding. But what I am going to do, I'm going to bring this whole thing to a head, and I'm going to talk to you about, again, this church in Philippi. This church in Philippi, the very beginning of the series, we talked about this was the first church in Europe, northern Greece, in an area called Macedonia. And it was there was nothing really spectacular about this area, other than the fact that these were people that loved the Lord. But they didn't have, they didn't have anything that just made them exceptional by human standards. But they did exceptional things. They did amazing things because they were followers of Jesus. And you see, all throughout this series, the thing that we've been talking about is we've been talking about this concept of identity. You see, one of the things that's so hard to convey to people and it's so hard to get them to understand is that you are a new creation when you come to Christ Jesus. But the old you still remains. The simple fact of the matter is that you are one person prior to your encounter with Christ. You just are. You're a person that doesn't really have a life centered on God. You're a person that really doesn't know who God is. Doesn't mean you're a terrible person. Doesn't mean you're like a villain or anything like that. It just means that you are living your life by a certain point of view. And the biggest thing in your life is you. And that's just the way it is. And so you go through life and you have this identity that's formed around who you are, and God isn't necessarily a part of that. But then something amazing happens. Those of you that encounter Jesus Christ, and I don't mean religion, I mean real encounter with Jesus. He comes into your life, whether it be just gradually or whether it be in one of those moments where you are just blown away and you come into the presence of God through your relationship with Jesus, and then you are somebody new. But the problem is, you don't really believe it. You see, this is that battle of faith. I tell people all the time, if you're a non-believer and you're here today, just hear me clearly. I don't struggle in my faith in Jesus, whether or not he's real, whether or not he actually existed, whether or not he's alive today and he's in heaven. I have no problem with that at all in my faith. I'll tell you where my battle of faith is: to believe that I am who he says that I am. I just don't necessarily believe it. Because you see, I know who I was. And I know that by virtue of my selfishness and my self-driven agenda and my lack of complete consideration for God, that was offensive to him. God is worthy of my praise, and I went around just worshiping myself. I know that about myself, and because I did that, I did things that I should have never done. So now here I stand in this place where I'm following Jesus, and I know he's alive. I know who he is. I just can't believe that he's fully forgiven me for everything that I was. And see, this is the battle. You know, I always tell you there's two parts to the gospel. There's the front end, which is a salvational piece. It's about coming to know Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. That's huge. That's first. It's big. And that is what we want for people, is to know Jesus, because that has eternal repercussions. But then there's the second part of the gospel, which is that you are journeying on this path to becoming who God has always called you to be. You're something more than what you were, and you are in a process of discovering who that person is, and it's a process that goes on until the day that you go into your eternal reward, the day you get to heaven. But a lot of people don't believe that. They just think, well, you know, get saved, and then from there you just kind of go through the motions until you die, and then you go to heaven. It's got nothing to do with it. It's about who are you in Jesus, because that's who you're going to be for eternity. We battle with this idea of identity. And see, Paul is writing to this church in Philippi, and he knows that he planted this church over 10 years ago. And you remember in Acts chapter 16, the first converts in Philippi, Lydia, she was a clothing merchant. She had money, but not to diminish women, but 2,000 years ago, she was still a woman. And in that culture meant she had absolutely no influence other than what she could spend money on. But she, you know, if you're going to build a church and you're looking to get, you know, pillars of influence in the church, and, you know, you don't start with a woman in that culture. Now, it's different now. But back then, women were... they were just second-class citizens, and it's just the way it is. And so this church in Acts chapter 16, it began with the first convert was this woman named Lydia, who actually opened up her house to the church in Philippi. And then the second convert was a teenage slave girl that was possessed by demons. And Paul freed her of her demons. And so here, so the first two converts in Acts chapter 16, two women, which, in that culture, doesn't make any sense. And then the third convert in Acts chapter 16 was a jailer. He was a blue-collar guy. We know in that culture that becoming a jailer was usually something somebody did after they were too old to be a soldier. And it's not a real good position, because jails were miserable then. I mean, just terrible. And so the jailers, you know, just a blue-collar guy. But Paul was imprisoned in Philippi. And while he was imprisoned in Philippi, he witnessed, there was this amazing earthquake and just through a series of events, the jailer comes to know Jesus and his whole household. And so this is the beginning of the church in Philippi. And it's from this humble beginning that we have this letter, this church, that Paul writes that is nothing but joy. And he's just amazed at what these people are doing. But in his letter, he's reminding them, remember who you are. Don't let the enemy, the powers and the principalities of this world, don't let them hijack your identity in Christ. Don't let it happen. You've got to trust in the Lord. You've got to rejoice in the Lord. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You need to fix your thoughts on all things that are noble and pure and admirable. You need to fight. You need to work hard. Because there's going to be forces against you that the last thing they want is for you to be who Christ says you are. They do not want you walking in that freedom at all. Tell you a story. Marcy came up here and she talked about systematic theology, and we invite people here at The Way. Obviously, we work our way through a textbook that's about that big. But it's a real quick, easy read. And I tell you, last year, I mean, you talk to people that took it last year. But here's what we do. We don't just talk about who God is. There's a little thing in theology called applied theology. See, it doesn't do any good to know what the Bible says. The question is, how do you apply it? And how do you make it relevant to people so that then when they're in a unique situation, they can approach the Word of God, they can approach who God is, and in that, they can receive something that actually helps them in the moment. And why is that so important? Because, you see, you never know when you're going to get a phone call and you're going to respond to a situation where a husband and wife are in crisis. The husband this just happened to me. The husband had done something. He had fallen into sin, and he had done something, and now it was out, and his world was collapsing. The marriage was in crisis, and all he could think of, the only way out is for me to kill myself. And he's a believer. And I'm sitting there with this person, and as he's telling me about how he's fallen into temptation and how this is now brought him to a point where there's no hope, he's ruined his life, and he looks at me, and he's basically looking at me to say, what now? See, this is applied theology. What now? Do we really believe that you're in until you screw up? Do we really believe that the gospel is, hey, believe in Jesus, and don't make any mistakes? Is that the gospel? Or is the gospel, when you trust in Jesus Christ, you become a new creation? And you need to live according to that new creation. You need to live a life worthy of what Jesus has done and his sacrifice. And you need to stop being who you think you are. And you need to start being who Jesus says you are. Is that the gospel? I remember my pastor, Kevin Corver, who I always talk about and I love, he told me words years ago that I'll never forget. He said, Steve, never get in the trap as a pastor of only telling people what God is against. You tell people what God is for. You tell people what God is for. And you see, in religion, we like to talk about what God is against. God's against this. God's against that. God's against this. But what is God for? See, it's a whole different mindset. It's a whole different thing. I could sit here, yes, God hates sin. And I could sit here and for the next 5 months, I could take one sin and I could highlight that and I could just talk for 30 minutes on every one of those sins. I'll just work through it. It's only a matter of time before we get to yours. Or I can work through the Word of God, and in that Word, you can hear who God says you are, and you can hear that God is not against you. He is for you, and He wants you to be more than what you are. That's the gospel. And see, that's what Paul is telling this church in Philippi. Do not allow your theology to get hijacked. Do not forget who you are. I'll tell you a story that this is all relevant to this meeting I had with this person. I'm going to kind of walk you through how I talk to this person in their situation. And it has everything to do with where we're at today. I'll start by telling you a story. If you're one of those people that loves to read, I'll give you a book that if you haven't read as a Christian, it's got to be on your list. And that's a book called Pilgrim's Progress by John Bunyan. It's a classic. Those of you that are kind of older, I'm sure you've heard of it. It's a classic book. I'm surprised that a lot of younger people have never heard of the book Pilgrim's Progress. It's a biggie. Now, the thing about Pilgrim's Progress is it was written over 400 years ago in the 1600s, and it's kind of old English. So when you first start reading it, it just kind of reads differently. But once you settle in, it's this amazing book. But Pilgrim's Progress is this beautiful and powerful word picture of the life of a follower of Jesus. And of course, it's a word picture of the gospel. So if I talk about it, I'm not kind of giving away anything, because if you know the Bible, you know how the book goes. But just a couple things to talk about. The book Pilgrim's Progress, the main character is a man named Christian. And Christian, it starts out at the beginning of the book. Christian has all of these burdens, all of his sins, all of the things that he's done. And he's literally walking around with all of these burdens. And they're just weighing him down. And he's just, you know, he's looking for something that's going to free him of these burdens. And he encounters the cross at Calvary. He literally encounters Jesus. And as he comes to believe, the straps on these burdens and all the things that he's carrying around, they literally rip and they fall to the ground. And now he's free. And we'd kind of think, oh, well, that's a good story. That must be the end. No, that's not even halfway through the book. You see, what begins then is he begins his journey. And he's walking on this journey, and the point that he's headed to is the celestial city or heaven. And along the way, he starts encountering all of these people, and all of their names have significance. He encounters people named Hypocrisy. People, and all these names that come against him, and all these things, and it's interesting to watch the journey as he goes through. You know, Jesus says in John 14:6, he says, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." That's a word picture of a road. When Jesus says, "I'm the way, I'm the journey, I'm the path," we've talked about this before. As a Christian, the life of a Christian is a journey. The destination is heaven. And it's about all the things that happen along the way. Well, Christian, as he's walking on this journey, he's on this highway to his destination. He's walking on this road. At one point, he picks up a companion named Hopeful. So Christian and Hopeful, they're walking down this road together. And eventually, this highway that they're on, this road, it becomes rocky. Really rough terrain. And it's kind of hard going through this terrain. And so they see an easier way, a way that looks easier. They start looking for an easy path, and they find a way called the easy way path. And they decide to walk down the easy way path, and at one point they get captured. They get captured by two giants. The first giant, the husband, the giant's name is Despair. And the second, his wife's name is Diffidence. Diffidence is an old word. And a lot, if I ask you, do you know what diffidence means? Most people are like, difference? No, diffidence. D-I-F-F-I-D-E-N-C-E. Here's what it means. Shyness or fear that comes from a lack of confidence. So despair and shyness or fear that comes from a lack of confidence. This is the husband and the wife. They take Christian and Hopeful. They put them in the dungeon. The castle is called Doubting Castle, which they are starved and tortured. And at one point, Despair says to Christian, "This is going to go on and on and on and on, and your only way out is to kill yourself. And Christian says, you know what? He turns to Hopeful and he says, you know what? I think he's right. I can't handle this anymore. I think we should kill ourselves. And Hopeful, being Hopeful, says to Christian, just hang on longer. Maybe the giants will make a mistake. Maybe they'll leave a door unlocked. Maybe they'll somehow turn their backs and we can get away. But don't. Let's just hang on. Let's just persevere. Let's just stay together and just see. Just look for an opportunity to get out of here. And so, again, the giants come and they torture them. They mistreat them. They just really, get on them. And they continually say, your only way out is to kill yourself. And, of course, Christian would be like, oh, maybe he's right. And then at one point, Christian suddenly remembers that in his heart is hidden a key. And the key is called promise. And he thinks to himself, maybe this key will open the lock to our jail. So he takes out this key called promise. He puts it in the lock and the door opens. And this key called promise opens every single lock in Doubting Castle. And eventually Christian and Hopeful, they get out and they get into the sun. And you see, the giants can't stand the light. So once they make it to the light, they're safe. Now, do you see how this is a metaphor for the life of a Christian? Promise. Do you believe that you are who Jesus says you are? Or do you believe that you are who you've always been and what the world says you are? There's a big difference. And it's a key to your identity. We talked about how the battleground's in your mind. You get kind of brought into this place where you think to yourself, oh, you know, one of the things I talk about with married couples, I take them through a book called Sacred Marriage. And Gary Thomas, he talks about something that I always find fascinating. And this may be convicting, I don't know. But he talks about how the married couple, sometimes they transition. When he talks to newlyweds or engaged couples, and he'll take one of them to the side, and he'll say, hey, tell me about your fiance or your newly married husband or wife. And when he does that, inevitably, they'll say things like, oh, he is this, he is that. Oh, he always does this, and then the husband says, oh, she's, you know what, she is this. She's so awesome. She's always that. That's kind of their mindset. Years down the line, when there's trouble, he'll do the same thing, same couple, and say, tell me about your husband or your wife. And they'll say, he never does this. He never is that. She isn't this. She never does this. And they talk, they've made this transition from who the person is to now who the person isn't. And you make the same transition when it comes to God. Let me ask you a question in all fairness. When you think about who you are before Christ, is it easier for you to say who you are or who you aren't? Well, I'm not this. I'm not that. See, this is that battlefield of the mind. The person's the same person. It's just now, through circumstances, whatever it is, you have decided to see the worst in the person instead of the best. Well, you do that to yourself when it comes to Jesus. And you know what the sad thing is a lot of religious people will help you. They'll come right alongside and they'll say, yeah, you know what, you aren't this. You'll never be that. And Jesus is saying, you are a new creation. When you are in me, you are a new creation. So what I want to do for you as we kind of hit this point home is I want to actually, since we've been through all the words in the book of Philippians, I want to give you the condensed version. You know, we've been talking about throughout this series how Philippians is kind of this coffee cup book where there's all these, you know, if you talk to a lot of Christians that read Scripture and you ask them, what's your favorite book in the Bible? They'll oftentimes tell you a verse out of Philippians. Not always, but sometimes. I mean, it's probably one of the more popular books out there. But what I want to do is I want to take a lot of these popular verses and I want to read them from start to finish. All together, all one continuing thought. And what I want you to do, you're not going to be, you could, I got the words up on the screen, and you could follow along, but don't be afraid too just to listen. Because you see, these are your words. These are not words written 2,000 years ago that no longer apply to some church in Northern Grace. These are timeless words written to followers of Jesus. And if you are a follower of Jesus, these are words for you. So we're going to start in chapter 1, verse 3, and we're going to read all the way through. So hear the word of the Lord. Every time I think of you, I give thanks to my God. Whenever I pray, I make my requests for all of you with joy. For you have been my partners in spreading the good news about Christ from the time you first heard it until now. And I'm certain that God, who began the good work within you, will continue his work until it's finally finished on the day when Christ Jesus returns. For I want you to understand what really matters, so that you may live pure and blameless lives until the day of Christ's return. May you always be filled with the fruits of your salvation, the righteous character produced in your life by Jesus Christ. For this will bring much glory and praise to God. For I fully expect and hope that I will never be ashamed, but that I will continue to be bold for Christ as I've been in the past, and I trust that my life will bring honor to Christ, whether I live or die. For to me, living means living for Christ, and dying is even better. Above all, you must live as citizens of heaven, conducting yourselves in a manner worthy of the good news about Christ. Then whether I come and see you again or only hear about you, I will know that you are standing together with one spirit, one purpose, fighting together for the faith, which is the good news. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and one purpose. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. You must have the same attitude that Christ had. Dear friends, you always followed my instructions when I was with you. And now that I'm away, it's even more important. Work hard to show the results of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. Whatever happens, my dear brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. I never get tired of telling you these things, and I do it to safeguard your faith. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For His sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage, so that I could gain Christ and become one with Him. I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law. Rather, I became righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with Himself depends on faith. No, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it, but I focus on this one thing. Forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He's done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And now, dear brothers and sisters, fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Keep putting into practice all you've learned and received from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing. Then the God of peace will be with you. Not that I was ever in need, for I have learned how to be content with whatever I have. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I have learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it's with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. And this same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from His glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. Now, all glory to God our Father forever and ever. Amen. Your words for you, so that you can live a life of freedom as you become what Jesus Christ has called you to be. You've got to believe it about yourself. Think about the greatest stories out there, all the great movies, all the great books. There's a theme that runs through them. Think about it. You start out with a character that has failed somehow, or in the eyes of people is some kind of lowly character, and they find themselves in unique circumstances, and somewhere in the face of these circumstances they decide to rise up and they decide to do something that's totally above their nature. They want to be noble. They want to be great. They want to do something. They want to sacrifice for people. They want to serve a purpose bigger than them. And as they do this, they become heroes. They become winners. It's the greatest stories there are. Why do we love that story? Because that's God's story. That's our story. That is the story of redemption. Take these people that they're just in circumstances. They feel low. They've done things that they regret, and they're in this place, and they are given this opportunity to do something great and noble and become winners and victors. And we love that story because that's God's story. It's God's story. Satan hates that story. He hates it. He'd much prefer a story where somebody great becomes less, and they somehow screw up, and everybody just attacks them, and everybody just, you know, casts them out and shuns them and leaves them alone, isolated, and they just end up taking their own lives. What is God for? He's for you. Not to live a self-centered, sinful life. He's not for that. He's for you to become centered on Jesus and become something great that brings Him glory. It's an amazing story. I want to, you know, the world twists this. I'll tell you where the world goes awry on this. This is not a power of positive thinking message. The world kind of turns it into that. Because what they do is they take God out of the equation. And they say, just if you believe it, you can do it. You just got to believe in yourself. But what they're saying is believe in yourself apart from God. They take the message of the gospel and they make it all about the human, the person. But if you change believe in yourself to believe in your Christ self, then suddenly it becomes, everything makes sense. Case in point, I got this video. It's this motivational video. It's called Believe in Yourself. You listen to the words they're saying. Now, I don't think they said this to honor God. But what they did is they're basically preaching the gospel. They're preaching what we've been talking about for the last 2 months. They don't give any credit to God, but we're going to credit God. When we hear in this video, believe in yourself, you know that believe in your Christ self. And watch this video.
Your brain is like a circuit switch. Once you believe you are something, you actually embody it. You embody that feeling. If you were, God forbid, in a coma, and you woke up and you didn't really have a memory, and you were told that you used to be a Navy SEAL, and they want you back now when you're healthy, do you think you'd act differently and hold yourself differently, conduct yourself different, and have a different self-concept of who you are than if you were told you were a piano instructor? Being successful in life is all about having the proper belief system in who you are. Truly believing that you are something unique, that you are something special in that field. If you truly believe inside of you that you are one of the best actors in the world, you will be entirely different than if you're like, I hope I'm good. Your expressions will be totally different. Your tone of voice, You'll talk in a more convincing fashion. You'll use your natural voice instead of a scripted one. You'll be more emphatic. You'll be more real, more relatable. Our brain is like a circuit. And so if we introduce it with the proper wiring, you're going to go straight to your target. If you're unsure about who you are, then your dreams, your goals, they will never become a reality. Everyone has mental doubts in life, internal conflicts. Even the most successful people that you look up to, but they don't live there. It's how you handle those negative thoughts in that exact moment and overwhelm them with positive action. And that comes with this utmost confidence in yourself that you can handle the situation. Trust in yourself that you are better than the moment.
The greats think differently. The greats see differently, right? The greats have a different worldview. The greats, they approach the game in a totally different way. So I need you to do me a huge favor. I need you to think about what you're thinking about when your effort is low. Because if you can get this, if you can get this, you can get any success you want in life. You can have anything you want in life if you can get this. The next time you give a low effort, right? You give it 70% or 50% or 30%. I want you to think about what you're thinking about when your effort is low. If your effort is low, you're probably not thinking about the opportunity. You're probably thinking about the obligation. And when you think about E.T., how you stay pumped up. E.T. is how you stay on fire. E.T., how you always driven, even in the midst of trials and tribulations, even in the midst of your haters, when people try to break you and tear you down. E.T., how you stay strong. I keep thinking about the opportunity. Every single day, I'm thinking about the opportunity, and I'm not looking at this thing as an obligation. I'm not looking at this thing as something that I have to do or that I'm forced to do, right? Something that somebody's making me do. Every time I wake up, I'm thinking, I'm alive, baby. This is the day. This is an opportunity. If you want what you've never had before, if you want to do what you've never done before, if you want to be what you've never been before, change your mentality. And I want you to see that effort goes up when you look at it as, I got an opportunity of a lifetime. But you should be excited about the fact that you have an opportunity.
You see, as just in life, we have so much of the picture, but until God comes in, we don't have the full picture. You got people making videos and talking about things. These are truths, but these are truths because they're God's truths. What we do, the mistake we make, is we take God out of it, and we make it about us. But the same truths remain, and the truth is that you have the power in the name of Jesus to control your thoughts. And you can either think of all the things that you aren't, or you can think of the things that you are in Jesus. You can either live a life determined by the mistakes you've made, or you can live a life of freedom that's defined, that defines this new identity. And how you approach that, how you deal with that, and how you process that with the help of the Holy Spirit. What do you think the Holy Spirit wants to do? See, as you come in fellowship with the Holy Spirit, and you allow the Holy Spirit to bring you to this place, folks, you experience freedom like you've never experienced in your life. Let's go back to that person I was talking to. This Christian who saw no hope. They saw that they were devastated and they were ready to take their life. Let's apply theology. Do you want to know what I did? I did for them what I'm going to do for you. I read them a passage of Scripture. And I'm telling you that for the rest of your life, if you are ever in a spot where you think God doesn't love you, if you think God isn't for you, you read this passage of Scripture and it'll change your life. But you got to believe it. And you got to own it. And you got to make this your identity. And you got to live according to the Word of God. And if you're familiar with Scripture, you're going to know this. It's Romans 8, starting with verse 31. Hear these words for you today. As we think about your identity and who you are, this is what Paul says. He says, "What shall we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can ever be against us? Since He did not spare even His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, won't He also give us everything else? Who dares accuse us whom God has chosen for His own? No one. For God Himself has given us right standing with Himself. Who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us, and He's sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean He no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? As the Scriptures say, 'For your sake we are killed every day, we're being slaughtered like sheep.' No. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us. And I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today, nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord." So I read these words to this man who's ready to kill himself, and he weeps. He weeps. The accuser comes into your life and says, "You're not this. You'll never be that. God isn't for you. God is against this." And he speaks that and he speaks that, while the Holy Spirit says, "Remember who you are. Remember who I am. And live in freedom." That's the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for your word today. And Lord, I do thank you for this message of freedom. And my prayer is that we enter into this time of communion, that we can cast aside our burdens. We can cast aside any despair. And we know who you are. All we have to do is examine our hearts. Do we truly want you in our lives? Do we truly want to walk a life of obedience? Do we want to walk that journey where we trust you? Lord, we pray that you'd bless this time. You would bless us as a people together. And Holy Spirit, would you work that miracle that you do in this time of communion, where we experience a greater presence and power of Jesus. Bless our time. We pray this all in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. I've told people that, and I've told you all this before, there's two things that I live for in this world. Number one, I live to see people come to know Jesus. I mean, there's nothing like it. And I live for it. But I'll tell you, maybe not quite as big as that, but just as important, is I love to see people when they start to understand who they are in Jesus. See, they're not the same. But when that happens, I'll tell you what, I love it. And it's just unbelievable, because see, that's where all the freedom is. And I want you to walk in freedom. You know, we're going to transition into a new series, starting with our ministry year kickoff next week. And that series is called Grace Wins. And we're going to be talking about the power of God's grace. So come back. Join us as we launch into our ministry year. Please stand and receive this blessing as I dismiss you here today. I pray that you know who you are in Jesus, and that you leave here now knowing the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ the Son, and the fellowship and the power of the Holy Spirit now and always. God bless you. You're dismissed. Have a great weekend and a great week.